Baby Seeds Mazzy. And once upon a time in 1969. I was 15 years old. I turned 15 years old the summer of 1969 in August. And that month, this album came out, the soundtrack to Easy Rider. I bought it right when it came out. I had my, I didn't have a driver's license, but one of my friends, who was 16, had his license. And we drove to Tower Records, and I bought this album, Tower Records, Columbus and Bay in San Francisco. And we went over to his house, and we played some records for a while. And he was giving me a ride home. We went out to his car. I had to get something out of my wallet or my pocket. I don't remember exactly what happened. And you know those things when you put something on the roof of your car and you forget? Did you ever seen Raising Arizona, the Coen Brothers film, where they put the baby in the car seat on the top of the car and they forget it's there? Well, I put this bag on the top of my car, on the top of my friend's car. I got in. And we start driving away, and all of a sudden he looks in his rearview mirror and he says, "Do you have your record bag, your Tower record bag? Because I just saw a Tower record bag fly off from the top of my car, and the car behind me ran over it." So I had to eventually get another copy of Easy Rider. This is 1969. I'm going to show you, it was a lot of records, a lot that you all know. I'd say you know 99% of these records, probably two-thirds of them a lot of you people have. And I'm sure everybody here has at least one, if not more, from 1969. But 69, it was great to be in San Francisco at 15 in 1969. It was, you know history. And the reason I'm doing this video, because I saw Quentin Tarantino's new film twice now, Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, that takes place in Hollywood. And the bottom line, I'm not gonna give any spoilers. I love the film. There's some few little issues with it. You could, go through and pick out and everything, pick out. But ultimately it's a buddy film of two friends, a washed up actor and his stunt man in Hollywood. Someone who came out of the late 50s TV into movies in the early mid 60s. And are all of a sudden in Hollywood at a time when Hollywood was changing and just the culture in general was changing. And these are kind of almost like has-beens in a way. They're from the old school of Hollywood. Well, I'm gonna start out with showing five films and then a bunch of records from 1969. And the big deal, the big change, and I noticed it even just as a 15-year-old, because I was going to the movies all the time. My girlfriend and I, my buddies, we were at the movies every weekend, if not sometimes during the week, but at least in the summertime, you know, probably we saw 3-4 movies a week, maybe. But it was a time where Hollywood was changing. In a way, the anti-hero was coming about. The independent film, in a way, and there's no film that represents it more than Easy Rider, a film with Dennis Hopper and Peter Fonda. And as you all know, Jack Nicholson, who thrust him into the limelight, and he won an Academy Award for Best Supporting Actor. The film was directed by Dennis Hopper, and it was one of the first uses of rock music to the extent. Songs by Steppenwolf, Born to Be Wild, The Pusher, songs by Roger McGuinn from The Byrds, and actually the band version of The Wait. And unfortunately, the soundtrack, they use a version by a band called Smith. Must have been a licensing issue, but it was a big mistake in my opinion, but it's a whole other thing. But the anti-hero was part of Hollywood, and it was what was going on in America. That year, Easy Rider came out of nowhere and burst on the scene, and is an important picture that, if you know, is it dated now? Maybe, but it's still a very, very powerful film on so many levels. The other one, the biggest grossing film of 1969, Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid. Hollywood film, yes, but again, the anti-hero, Butch Cassidy. I could definitely do without Raindrops Keep Falling on My Head. If I could cut out that scene of Paul Newman on the bicycle with Ross, what's her name? Not Annie Ross, Catherine Ross. I would excise that film out, especially in 1969, that B.J. Thomas lighthearted romp. It probably won Best Song too, I don't even remember. But great movie. The other movie that kind of came out of nowhere, and I saw it at 15 years old. I don't know how I saw it, because it was X-rated. And in those days, the ratings were just kind of starting those few years. And X-rated was because of the nudity and the violence and the subject matter. I don't think I quite got the film, but it won Best Motion Picture, the first X-rated film to win Best Picture as an Oscar. But John Voight and Dustin Hoffman, just an amazing film. John Schlesinger film. Again, the anti-hero in Hollywood cinema. It changed the rating to an R later in that year or the next year, but Midnight Cowboy. Of course, Sam Peckinpah's The Wild Bunch, very violent, one of the most violent films of the time, but again, a great Hollywood masterpiece. But in a way, Peckinpah was sort of the anti-Hollywood way away from the establishment. And another film from the UK, The Italian Job. Obviously, most of you probably know the version with Mark Wahlberg, the remake, which is a great movie on its own, but the original with Michael Caine, again, playing the anti-hero. So those five films. Okay, I'm gonna go through the records fairly quickly, but one band I need to call out is Creedence Clearwater Revival. Out of the Bay Area, out of El Cerrito, California. But the amazing thing is, talk about, they put out three albums in 1969. Bayou Country, Born on the Bayou, Wooly and the Poor Boys, and Green River, all of which had top hits in the top 40. Green River, Bad Moon Rising, Lodi, Born in the Bayou, Good Golly Miss Molly, Proud Mary, a song which every friggin' lounge act started playing. Proud Mary got to be a bit of a joke in a way, but it's a great song. Wooly and the Poor Boys, photographed in Oakland, California. Fortunate Son, Midnight Special, It Came Out of the Sky, Cotton Fields. But Fortunate Sons and Down on the Corner. Fortunate Son really epitomizes the time perfectly. Great protest song. The first album by Delaney and Bonnie, Accept No Substitute. I'm a big fan of theirs, but their first album came out here in 1969. Little offbeat here was Jane Birkin and Serge Gainsbourg's album, French Pop, The Yee Girl Experience, Model Turned Singer Ingenue, great record. Frank Zappa, Hot Rats. As I go through these and as I was pulling these, you know, there's a lot of great years for music. 67, 68, 66, 71 and 2. I mean, you can get into the 80s and 90s or anything, but 1969, every album, and I figured out 90% of these records I bought as they came out. I had summer jobs, I had jobs after school. Records were $3. Of course, we didn't make that much, but I put all my money into records. The cliche of sneaking the record bags home as they grew so your parents wouldn't see you spending all this money on records, but they were cool about it. Leo Kottke's first album, Guitar Player, 6 and 12 string on Tacoma Records, which was John Fahey's label. Jethro Tull, Benefit. I'm sorry, Stand Up. Wrong album. Did that scare you? See, this isn't the band. This is the band called Smith. What's that about? Oh, I don't even have a band album. I forgot to pull a band album, but anyway. Joe Cocker, who got famous at the Woodstock Festival the next year, but he was on the radio, but Woodstock happened in August of 1969, the Woodstock Festival, but the movie didn't come out till 1970, but Joe Cocker had two albums that year, well, 68, 69, A&M Records. Pink Floyd's Uma Guma. Uma Guma, Uma Guma, I think it's Uma Guma. Great cover by Hypnosis, early Hypnosis. One studio album, which is broken down into quarters. Each member has a segment of them to indulge themselves, as we might say, and one LP of all live stuff. I remember the weekend this album came out. I was 15 years old, I guess, and I went to a friend's house. They were a little older, and I was spending the night over their house. And there was like four of us, and two of the guys took mushrooms, and I had never taken any kind of drugs to that point. I didn't take drugs that night. But we kept listening to this album over and over again, and my two friends on mushrooms. It was a great experience. We had black lights going and strobe lights, and it was like a typical Hollywood movie, but I was this 15-year-old kid, subversive, right? Horrible. They could have influenced me to go to the other side. But look at me now. What, how many years later? 50 years later. I survived. Always love that. Obviously, the first Crosby, Stills & Nash album, also a band that really broke because of their Woodstock show. Nothing really to say about this album. Times Are Changed with singer-songwriters. Joni Mitchell, Clouds, 1969. Johnny Cash, San Quentin, both his prison albums, San Quentin and Folsom, huge records. And this one was huge because of, oh, I'm wrong. Oh, Walk the Line was on here, but Boy Named Sue's on the other one. Oh no, A Boy Named Sue is here. Boy Named Sue, top 10 single, was censored out until the reissue CD of, I'd say, the last 15 years, the uncensored version. This is one album I did not get at the time. I didn't get probably till well into the late 70s. The Byrds. The first Chicago Transit Authority record. I remember buying this only because it was a double album for only a dollar more. Usually double albums were a lot more money at the time, back in the day, 1969. But this album was only a dollar more, and this really broke. This is a great album. After their second or third album, I kind of lost faith in them. Once they started doing, I think this band, Chicago, is the band that destroyed Roman numerals. They got a little M.O.R., so Roman numerals got fucked because of Chicago, right? I mean, their version of I Am a Man, Beginnings, great record, Columbia Records. Now, Fleetwood Mac, Then Play On. I'd say this is one of their best records way before the Buckingham Nicks period, 1969. I mean, look at that band. Oh, man. Now this is a copy with Oh Well. Oh Well was not on all the original copies, and it came out. In fact, the UK copy wasn't in, I think, the first pressing. This has Oh Well on it, which is an amazing song. But Fleetwood Mac, Then Play On, amazing album. I just showed this, one of my favorite albums. I showed it in my Leech and Leaf video, in my contest video. In fact, there's a contest going on now, so look at the video before this that shows the contest. Who are these people? I don't know who they are. Songs from a Room, the great, great Leonard Cohen. Bird on the Wire, Leonard Cohen. Now, the Dead had two, I think the Dead had, was Axum Oxa or Anthem of the Sun came out. I don't have that here, but I do have Live Dead, which is an amazing, amazing record. These are from 1969 Fillmore shows. In fact, there's a couple box sets that have come out the last couple years at Record Store Day that showcases these as well. These shows, expanded versions. There you go. I just showed this on another video too. Flame Breather Brothers, The Gilded Palace of Sin with Graham Parsons, 1969. My favorite Kinks record, Arthur, 1969, celebrating its 50th year. In fact, all these records are celebrating the 50th anniversary. And the thing is, these records still hold up, right? I didn't get this at the time, Velvet Underground's second album, 1969. With Jesus, Candy Says, Verve Records. I didn't get this at the time, but it's a record you should all get, Dusty in Memphis, Dusty Springfield, one of the great female vocalists of the 1960s, probably the great white soul singers, British artist, great record, Dusty in Memphis. I got this at the time, a friend of mine turned me on to it, Hot Buttered Soul by Isaac Hayes. I mean, it has long, long songs. I mean, the first side has two songs, a 12-minute song and a 9-minute song. That's not why I like him. I had hair, had long hair when I bought that album. One of two covers of the Blind Faith album. The super group that lasted a minute, 2 minutes maybe. This is with Stevie Winwood, Eric Clapton, Ginger Baker, Rick Gretsch. But this is a wonderful record. Bob Dylan Goes Country. Bob Dylan's voice changes. He comes out of nowhere. Does a duet with Johnny Cash. Johnny Cash had a TV show going on television at the time, too. So I'm going to flip the record. Ba-da-bum, goddamn the pusher man, goddamn that man, that pusher man. Don't sing, Maslov. Okay, now, Fraternity of Man.
Don't bogart that joint, my friend, pass it over to me.
I bought this album when it came out. I returned it the next week. I bought it again. I didn't get it. I bought it again 10 years later. I didn't get it when I was 15 years old.
Just like the other one. You've been hanging on to it.
The Who, Tommy. First time I went to the Fillmore West, I saw The Who perform Tommy live, the complete Tommy. It was like just weeks, I believe, after this album came out, 1969, Tommy at the Fillmore. Amazing show. 15-year-old kid. He's probably not even 15 yet. One of the great records. My second favorite Who album after Who Sell Out. First Neil Young record. I bought this, I had no idea what it was. I bought it because of the cover. And then, you know, King Crimson. In the Court of the Kings and, I knew I was gonna do that. Mazzy trips over his lips all the time. Greg Lake.
Robert Fripp. Prog was kind of invented, right? I mean, I'm sure that, you know, you prog freaks know prog before this, but for me, this is probably my first prog album, at least first prog album that I know of ever getting. You know, 1969, Let It Bleed, The Rolling Stones. One of my very favorite Stones albums. This and Beggar's Banquet are my two all-time favorite Rolling Stones records. Everybody sing along this time. What can I say about this? 1969. And of course, last but not least, Abbey Road. So 1969, and they just put out the 50th anniversary of Woodstock. This is the 50th anniversary 5 LP box set. By no means complete. It's basically kind of an overview. The original record was 3 LPs. If you wanted to pony up $800, they just put out this amazing design, beautiful, gorgeous box set of, was it 38 CDs? It's the entire concert. It's the first time that every band licensed their music for the Woodstock Festival. You know, if you're into it, all the power. I mean, it's great music. I can't even imagine just the licensing time and legal negotiations to get all the artists to add their music to that collection. Including and adding on top of that the editing and mastering and mix and remixing, and the package design of the limited edition is amazing. But I just went for a 5 LP set that's a fraction of the shows, and I'm about to jump into this weekend. But that's it. So that's Once Upon a Time in 1969. Mazzy loves you. Enter my contest. If you're watching this in the year 2025, you're too late. The contest goes till the end of August 2019. But there's a lot of records I forgot, or I didn't forget, but I just didn't pull out. It was a great, great year for music. You know, any of these bands, to me, are just classic bands. Anyway, Mazzy loves you, and take care, VC. Thanks for watching again.